Hello, so welcome to the Introduction to Plant Pathology class. Today I'm going to be discussing about plant disease management and some of the principles for the management of plant disease epidemics, and I'm going to cover a few topics on the chemical control and some of the biological control agents and things like that throughout this lecture. So the first thing that I want to describe, I guess, it would be the goal of plant disease management. That is basically is to reduce the economic and aesthetic damage caused by plant diseases. So what I mean is that we want to maintain disease levels below the economic threshold, and many times to be able to do that, we don't need to the complete elimination of the plant disease. If we try to achieve that, it's gonna lead us to unnecessary and unacceptable costs due to the chemicals they're gonna be using and stuff like that, and also because of the labor, and also we may be adding additional environmental impacts since we're gonna be using like more and more chemicals for control. And this is just, I'm just showing here a picture of citrus canker, showing how some of this fruit is just basically unmarketable just because of the damage that is on the rind of the citrus. The types of losses that plant diseases cause there are several. The first one that is everybody's familiar with is of course the direct yield reduction, and this could happen either because maybe fruit drop, and then you're gonna get a reduced production of fruit, or flowers, if the disease attacks flowers, and then you're gonna get less fruit. But also, even if you have fruit is the end product, and the disease is attacking the leaves, you may have, because you have less photosynthetic area, then you're gonna have either a smaller fruit or reduced number of fruit as well. So yield reduction is like the main one and is the most important, but also the quality of the fruit or the quality of the product is reduced, and we're talking about the cosmetics of it. If it has damage on the skin, and then that fruit becomes unmarketable, or also the production of toxins, aflatoxins or other types of toxins that then it cannot be consumed by humans, and sometimes it cannot even be consumed by animals either. Plant diseases also add increased costs for the pesticides, and also sometimes the breeding programs or the hybrids that are used may cost a little bit more if it's a specific disease for an area. Certification programs, they're like some crops like citrus and also like potatoes, they require certified seed or certified buttwood to be able to be planted. And sometimes quarantines, depending on if a new disease comes in, the cost of quarantines also add up to the increased costs of production. And then, and as well as sometimes limiting the types of crops that can be grown in a particular area, that may also increase sometimes the losses. And so the first thing that it's very, very important for management of a disease is the correct diagnosis. So basically, you need to identify the pathogen, which is the real target of a disease management program. And I mean, this is just a picture of late blight of tomato that is caused by Phytophthora infestans. And basically, in order to be able to apply the correct management program, you need to know exactly what pathogen you are targeting, because you don't want to apply a fungicide that is not going to work on Phytophthora. So for plant disease management, they rely on anticipating the occurrence of the disease. And basically what we want to do is want to attack the vulnerable part in the disease cycle. So, I mean, this is something that we discussed before about the disease cycle, and basically the first step is inoculation. pre-penetration, penetration, infection, and colonization. So basically what we want to do is just like a break at some point in the disease cycle, so our management strategy to be able to work. So when we talk about, or we think about the disease triangle, basically what we're gonna be doing, we're looking at the pathogen, we're looking at the environment, and we're looking at the host. And so what's gonna make our strategy, or the strategy that we're gonna be using most effective, is that first of all, we want the correct diagnosis, as I just mentioned before, which is necessary to identify the correct pathogen. So we're looking at, from the disease triangle, we're looking at the pathogen. And then we want to know the biology of the host in order to know like when is most susceptible to the specific pathogen. So basically now we're looking at the host counterpart like in the disease triangle. And then we also want to know the environmental aspects or which are looking at the environment. So basically, just as an example, apple scab outbreaks can be predicted based on the temperature and moisture conditions. So basically, depending on the environment, it's like, okay, you know that in this area, there's always apple scab or any other disease. And then you know that if the certain environmental conditions, such as rainfall or high moisture or cool temperatures are very conducive to disease, you know that, okay, well, we're getting this, so we should prepare for the arrival of the disease and try to control it before it becomes a huge epidemic. So those are some of the basics for effective disease management. Another thing that is gonna help us choose the right method for control of the diseases or management of disease of plant diseases is gonna be what type of epidemic is the one that it's present. So basically, so as we discussed previously in class, most plant disease epidemics can be monocyclic or polycyclic diseases. So in a monocyclic disease, basically the levels of infections are gonna depend pretty much on the initial inoculum or the primary inoculum, like how much disease is present or how much pathogen is present at the beginning of the season. And then from there it's gonna be like one cycle for the disease to occur, like through the whole cycle of the plant. It's just one cycle for the pathogen when we're talking about reproduction but then when we're talking about polycyclic diseases, they're gonna be producing secondary inoculum throughout the season, and then you're gonna have multiple rounds of infection. So how you manage the disease epidemics, it's gonna depend a lot of the pathogen or the disease, if it's monocyclic or polycyclic diseases. Okay, so for plant disease management of monocyclic diseases, we need to focus on reducing the amount of the efficacy of the primary inoculum. So basically, which is just like how much inoculum is at the beginning of the season, and the management, it's gonna be targeting to reduce that amount of inoculum. However, for polycyclic diseases, we wanna focus, of course, on reducing the primary inoculum, but also we're gonna try to attempt to slow the rate of disease increase. So basically, because there's multiple rounds of infection happening, it's like if we can extend it so it's not as fast reproduction of the pathogen, and then the rate of which disease is just advancing and just infecting the crop, then hopefully we're gonna be able to manage the disease better. So for plant disease control, we can either try to prevent the disease from happening. This is going to include some of the tactics that are applied before infection, either some regulatory methods, some cultural practices that are going to try to avoid or to prevent the infection to occur in the first place. But also therapy is also important, and when the plant is treated for the disease. So once the disease is present, it's like, what are you going to do? You can And you can either try to like direct control of pathogens with chemicals, biological control of pathogens with other microorganisms, and there's other methods that we're going to be discussing briefly. So for some of the strategies of disease management, of course, as just mentioned, prevention, so not cure. So of course, cure is only attempted in rare situations. So basically, what we want to do is just prevent. Like, we don't want the disease there in the first place. If we get the disease, then we want to try to reduce it. And basically, the disease incidence, so it's just try to reduce the disease incidence, which is just basically, okay, how many plants are infected, rather than try to eradicate the pathogen. Eradication is usually impossible, and it's always expensive, but that's the first step when you're when a new disease enters an area. Eradication is the first step, because you think, okay, well, the pathogen is not established and we're able to eradicate it, or we're able to just completely disappear from the area, and it works, then it's going to be better for the area in general. Because then you don't have to deal with the disease for a long time, and sometimes that's always the first step when a new disease arrives. Control, that's definitely, we want to control the initial inoculum or the primary inoculum, the secondary inoculum, and then the potential vectors, because vectors are also very, very important when we're talking about plant disease epidemics. And of course, integration of multiple approaches. Generally, whatever disease it is, one thing may not work. You may have to do like different things and integrate, have an integrative management program, which is going to include different types of control methods or disease management methods, but also it may have also other things like integrate some nutritional programs and things like that. So if you have a nice and healthy crop, it may be able to withstand disease much, much better. So obviously this integrative approach to have healthy plants, it's also very important. So the principles for plant disease management, there's just basically six of them. Avoidance, and we're gonna discuss each one of them separately. So we have avoidance, we have exclusion, eradication, and then we have protection, resistance, and therapy. So when we're talking about avoidance, in this principle, basically, the idea is that plants are gonna be grown at times or locations where the pathogens are either inactive or not present. So basically, for example, when we're talking about time, what we wanna do is either plant early and harvest early. Like if some disease, it's more prevalent at certain time of the year, but we're able to avoid it by harvesting early, so then we're gonna be one step ahead. So as an example is plant sugar beets after the spring flight of the leaf, the bit leaf doffer, leaf hoppers, which are vectors of the beet yellow virus. So basically, once you know, okay, at this time of the year, the vector is gonna be gone from this area, then you can avoid the virus to, the plants to be infected with the virus, just because you avoided that time when the vector was present. So once the vector was gone, then it's like, okay, it's time to plant. So that way is a good way to avoid some of the epidemics. Site selection is also very, very important, and we're trying to avoid disease because if the inoculum is not present or the conditions are not good for the pathogen growth or the survival of the pathogen, that's also really, really good for to avoid disease to occur. So we wanna, there's also, like when you're trying to do seed certification programs and things like that, that's one of the things that you wanna do. You want to avoid, or you wanted to select a site where some diseases are not present or very, very low, so you can do the seed certification or for But that's for a different principle in general. So changing the planting site. So this can also include like the have plantings in areas where they have better better drainage or improved drainage because of the slope of the soil. Modify the environment. So either you want to alter the temperature, the moisture, some of the ventilation, the soil pH. Those are things that are important when you try to avoid disease. And for soil pH, you want to, for example, you want to keep the pH less than 5.2 for potato scab, and or keep it at 7.2 for suppression of club rot or of crucifers. I mean, so depending on the crop and depending on the disease that you're trying to avoid, then is it, does the pH that what you want your soils to be at. And another example is just how to avoid damping off. And so damping off, in this picture, you can see with the red arrows, is just basically, it's a combination, the pathogen is just basically a combination of pathogens. So it's just basically, it can be Rhizoctonia, and it can be Fusarium, but it can also be Phytophthora that cause, that, it's a disease complex that causes damping off. And it just basically chokes the new seedlings. And for nurseries that produce, for example, tomato or very small plantlets that are going to be transplanted into the field, this is very, very important. It's a very serious problem, and I believe one of you is going to be presenting on damping off. But some of the things that are important is to avoid areas with either compacted or soils or soils with low drainage. So basically, you don't want like very high moisture to be present. Because that's gonna increase the disease incidence. Do you want to prepare the soils without low spots where water can accumulate? So basically, it's the same principle of having like good drainage and low moisture. Provide good air movement across planting areas, so you don't want to plant all the plants like so close there is no air to flow between the plants, so then that's going to increase the moisture levels, and then that can also increase the disease, because the pathogen is going to be thriving in those conditions. And also, it's always good to plant when temperatures are very good for germination and also for rapid growth of the seedlings. So of course, if you plant and your seeds germinate really fast and start growing really fast, I mean, they're gonna pass that area, that timing when they're very susceptible to the disease for them to start growing before, you know, they can get infected. So the next principle is exclusion. And basically, this one is defined as any measure that it's going to prevent the introduction of a new disease or a new pathogen into a region, a farm, a planting area. And the first one, which is one of the most important, is just basically quarantines, which are that imposes legal restrictions on the transport of plants, plant materials, seeds, or propagative parts. Soil or machinery that is going to prevent the spread of pests and pathogens into a new area. So quarantines are very, very important, but there are a lot of limitations to the success of quarantines. And one of them would be the natural dispersals of either the pathogen or the vector. I mean, sometimes it's really hard to control how far an insect can travel. And if that's the main vector for the disease that you're trying to control. Sometimes even if you have a team that is looking for the pathogen or the vector, the pathogen may be very microscopic, or if it's the plants are in a very early stages of infection, even with quarantine programs, it's going to be very hard to see those infections. Sometimes also insufficient resources or technical training are not enough for to be able to have a successful quarantine. And sometimes you need a very rapid testing to see if the pathogen is coming from commercial import or export. So the testing might not be as fast as needed for the commercial import and export. And so an example for this would be like Wanglong Bing in citrus or HLB. And so for example, in the picture below, what we can see is some very mild, basically symptoms of disease. But if you don't have a very trained eye to be able to see and distinguish that as HLB, it would be very, very hard, like in a shipment, to be able to say, oh, well, that's HLB. We have to test it, and you have to hold this truck with this load, you know, onto all the trees or are tested. And basically, this is, in a way, this is what it happened here in Texas, and that's why HLB is present, for example, in regions like in the Houston area. They went there into these trucks that were, it was a nursery, from nursery facilities from this area, from the lower Rio Grande Valley. There were shipments that went to the Houston area with citrus, but some of them had HLB in them. And these trucks, these loads, were USDA certified. It's not like they were not certified. I mean, but the personnel went there, looked for the disease, and the disease can resemble so many things that just basically just passed over, and it was, they were not able to detect some of these infected trees, and then that's why the disease is also present in different parts of the state. And in the upper picture, we can see the psyllids that are reproducing, and it's really hard to really control some of the vectors. And mainly for the commercial groves, there is a strict psyllid control management program to avoid the disease spread within the groves and also to other regions. But however, for residential areas where you have like homeowners that have their trees in their yard, they're not controlling for psyllids. So it's very easy to spread the disease by the natural movement of some of these insect vectors. Also, under the principle of exclusion, we have seed certification programs, but it's just basically some of the plants that are vegetative propagated and seed propagated can be certified as disease free. And basically the idea is that some of this crops or plants can be disease free when they are planted into an area. And it can be very important, especially for seed-borne viruses, because basically there is absolutely no cure for viruses. So you want to have virus-free seeds. And in a previous class, when we were discussing about viruses, we talked about the potato seed production and the different steps in the seed certification program for potatoes, but also citrus buttwood programs. Since we got HLB in the United States, basically the way that the buttwood programs work, it's completely different. And although the certification program is not in an area, like in a separate area, where citrus are not produced, they are inside the citrus producing area, they are grown under screen, the mother plants or the foundation blocks. They're covered with, they're just basically kind of produced indoors where you have these screens to avoid the entrance of the psyllid vectors. And also those trees are tested like every 6 months for all of the viruses and viroids, but also for HLB. So some of the certification, seed certification programs or buttonwood certification programs are very, very important. So the new trees or the new seeds that are planted are basically disease free. The next principle is just basically eradication, and the idea with this one, as we just mentioned before, is just the elimination of a pathogen after it has been introduced into a new area, but before it becomes well established. And so there are two separate methods for try to eradicate some of this. Some pathogens once they're arriving to a new area. So you may have like cultural practices, which is just basically crop protection, fallowing, flooding, host eradication. So, but that should have been the first one to mention. Like when we got HOB in Texas, I mean, the first thing that it was asked for growers to do is like, if you detect an HOB positive tree, you gotta remove this tree because we want to reduce the levels of inoculum. So that doesn't serve as inoculation point for like insects to come feed on it and then go and spread the disease all around. So that was actually the first one to host eradication, or I guess infected hosts eradication, not just any host. But also rugging infected plants, destroying alternate hosts. It's also important when you're trying to eradicate. Plowing or tillage, depending on the type of pathogen, sanitation programs. Heat is also a good method for eradication, and that includes like burning, steaming of soils and pots, composting can also help in when we're trying to eradicate. Soil solarization, hot water treatments, thermotherapy. So some of these methods are used to try to eradicate some pathogens, but definitely host eradication is the main one that is trying to eliminate the pathogen in a new area once it's introduced. So for cultural practices for eradication, the main one it would be crop protection. It's just basically to remove host materials for a few years to cause the decline in an obligate or host-dependent pathogen population. So basically, this is just a direct attack on the primary inoculum source. Some of the limitations are for perennial crops, for pathogens that can have a saprophytic lifestyle. So basically, they survive long periods of time in the soil, so it doesn't matter if you remove the host, they just basically don't care because they are happily living in the soil. And also for pathogens that have a very wide host range, so basically it doesn't matter. It's like, okay, you remove the host, but then you plant a different crop the following season, and then these pathogens can also infect the other host, so basically they don't care. For perennial crops, this is in a way not feasible because they're just gonna be there for 30 to 50 years. Like in the case of citrus, you can have a productive crop for over 30 years, and after 35 to 40 years, then it's time. I mean, depending on how well treated it is, you may be able to start. You should start replanting maybe after 30 to 40 years, but they can also last up to 50 years. The use of heat for eradication is also important. So basically, once you remove some infected materials, you have to burn them immediately. One example would be for citrus canker in Florida that is caused by Santomonas campestris patobar citrii. A lot of when it was this eradication program going on and trying to burn a lot of the trees that were infected they were trying to reduce the level of pathogen that was present, they would just basically cut and remove trees, and then they would burn the trees. Sometimes they basically destroyed entire citrus groves and nurseries, but they had to burn it. I mean, otherwise the pathogen would be just sitting there and start spreading to the other groves like immediately, so they had to be burned. For the principle of protection, this one depends on the establishing of a barrier between the pathogen and the host plant, or the susceptible part of the plant host. So, for example, in this picture, what we're seeing is that we have the banana plants, and then we have the fruit that is hanging, and basically they're protecting with these plastic bags the whole fruit, the whole hand, the hands of the banana, and the idea is that the pathogens are not going to be able to attack the fruit. So it's a way of protecting, it's just basically a physical barrier. Another type of barrier, it would be plant barrier crops, like for example to have some like a tall crop on one side and then you have a lower crop in the middle, and the idea is that some of the winds are not going to be bringing some of the other pathogens or pests or even some of the vectors. And another thing would be to have crop free periods. So basically it's like a time when it's like, okay, no crop is grown in this area for a certain period, for a few months of the year after harvest or something like that. And the idea is that, okay, the pathogens are gonna have to basically sometimes they just die out or start losing some of their viability. The use of reflective mulches, those ones also help in protecting a crop. Sometimes because if they're reflective, sometimes the insect vectors may not be attracted and may not get in to be infecting with viruses that they may carry and things like that. Sometimes apply insecticides or oils also help protect. And definitely planting resistance or tolerant host is another way to protect the plant. So if the plant is resistant and it's just immune to certain pathogens, you're basically protecting your crop from that pathogen. Biological control is also considered a form of protection. You can either have growth promoting rhizobacteria that is going to live in the roots of some of the plants, and it's going to promote the growth of the crop, and that's gonna help it in being more resistant to some diseases. Sometimes there's other fungi that can colonize some wounds. So basically what you're gonna do is, just because they colonize certain areas of the plant but they're not pathogenic, they're gonna be competing against the pathogens. And that way they're gonna keep them out from the plants. There are other bacteria that may have antagonistic effects against other pathogens. An example is Agrobacterium radiobacter that produces bacteriocin, which basically is antagonistic to other pathogens, and it just avoids the growth of other plant diseases, and it protects the plants when this agent is applied. Cross protection can also work, and it's just basically when you are inoculating a plant with a hypervirulent or a mild virus strain. And basically, this is going to prevent the infection with a virulent strain of the same pathogen. Resistance is another type of, it is another principle for disease management, and it's just basically the development of disease-resistant cultivars. And for sure, this is the most effective type of disease control that can be used. The idea would be, hopefully, to be a stable resistance, or more like a horizontal type of resistance, where you have a broad range of resistance, and it's not just one single strain of a pathogen that is going to be like more like broad range disease resistance. When we're talking about therapy. So in this case, we are treating the afflicted individual. So basically, we have chemical treatments where these ones can be either systemic treatments that can be, for example, tetracycline treatments on coconut palms during the lethal yellowing epidemics in Florida. And this, the idea of this is that if an individual plant, it's infected, you're going to be applying either a fungicide or an antibiotic to avoid some of the, not to avoid, but actually to treat some of these diseases and try to kill the pathogen so that some of these plants may survive. Sometimes surgery is also necessary on trees, which is just basically cutting limbs that are infected or dead branches and things like that. So the idea is that if that branch is infected, you cut it, and then you're getting rid of the infected part of the plant, and hopefully the rest of the plant is going to be able to grow and recover. Some of the therapy methods for chemicals, we can have disinfectants, herbicides, to get rid of some of the pathogen reservoirs, insecticides for vectors, seed treatments, soil treatments as fumigants or nematicides. In biological control, we may have hyperparasitism, predation, and hypovirulence, and I'm going to go over some of these ones a little bit more slowly. So how to assess or how to select the appropriate control measure? And there, so basically we need to take some things into context. And one of the things is that we have to analyze the disease dynamics. So the first thing, the first question that we need to ask is the disease monocyclic or polycyclic? If it's polycyclic, is the infection rate high or low? Where does the pathogen overwinter? Is it going to be in the cell debris? Is it going to be in the soil? Is it going to be in a vector? So we need some questions that we need to be asking ourselves before we decide what is the appropriate control measure. Another question would be, how's the primary inoculum levels? Or is it very high? Is it low? So we know what we're going to start with at the beginning of the season. Also, how critical is the primary inoculum in the disease cycle? So you see, like, really, really important, or is not as important, for example, in a polycyclic disease where the main source of infection, it would be the secondary inoculum, not the primary inoculum. So those are the things that we need to take into consideration. What plant parts are attacked? Are the plant parts susceptible throughout the growing season, like the whole season, or is just at the beginning of the season when the leaves are nice and tender, and once they're mature, they're not susceptible to the pathogen? It can be the other way around, that the pathogen is going to attack mature leaves, but it's not going to attack the young leaves. What other biological factors favor disease development? Is there a presence of an alternative host? Are vectors involved in the transmission of the disease? What are the environmental factors that favor disease development? Is it high moisture? Is it low moisture? Is it low temperatures or high temperatures? I mean, those are the things that we need to be looking at. And also, what's the duration of the host pathogen interaction? Is it going to be only for a certain period of time, or is it going to be, okay, once it's infected, it's just going to continue to grow throughout the whole season? Like if it's a fruit that gets infected, and once it's infected, it's just going to continue to grow until it infects the whole fruit, or is it going to be a very localized lesion, and things like that. So some of those are the factors that we're going to need to assess in order to pinpoint what's the best strategy for control of the plant disease. When we're thinking about chemical control, we have basically a list of chemicals that we can use, but of course we need to target those depending on the type of pathogen. So we have antibiotics, we're targeting bacteria. For fungicides, we're targeting fungus. Herbicides, plants, weeds. Nematicides for nematodes. When we're targeting or we're using insecticides, we're targeting the insect vectors. Rodenticides for rodents, and also biocides are basically broadly toxic and they're used for some soil fumigants and but basically those kill everything, good and bad and ugly and absolutely everything. So for bacterial control, antibiotics are the ones that we're gonna need. And so penicillin is a very important antibiotic. It interferes with the biosynthesis of the peptidoglycan layer of bacterial cell walls. And then because of that, then the bacterial cell lyses. It's not used to treat plant diseases, and basically because a lot of the antibiotics that are used for control of human diseases are based on penicillin. But it's an important antibiotic. However, streptomycin, it inhibits protein synthesis in prokaryotes, or basically in bacteria, and it's used for the control of fire blight, which is Erwinia millivora, bacterial pepper spot in tomato, tomato bacterial spot that is caused by Pseudomonas campestris pathobar versicatoria, that's also used as streptomycin. So tetracycline, it is also used for control of Pierce's disease of grapes, which is caused by Salmonella fastidiosa. And some other more general bactericides are copper-containing bactericides that provide partial disease control. And this one is used, the copper, for controlling citrus canker in Florida. But with some of these copper-containing bactericides, we have to be careful because copper is a micronutrient, which is needed for the plant, but it can also cause toxicities in the plant if applied at a very high level. So it's important to keep it under certain limits and not be over-applying some of these copper-containing bactericides. Nematicides are different from fumigants, which basically kill everything. Some of them are systemics in plant, like thymic, furadan. But those ones are very toxic, and some of them require like EPA permits, and some of them are just basically out of the market. There are new chemistries in nematicides that are becoming, like, they're getting introduced into the market, but a lot of the nematicides that were very, very effective that were taken out of the market just because they were so toxic that they were just completely, they were banned from the U.S. Insecticides are very important to decrease vector populations. So in the case of HOB, as we have been discussing, it's very, very important for disease management, just basically because there's no cure yet for HLV in the trees. So the only way of actually controlling disease spread, it would be to control the vector. Fungicides, they can be used as protectants, which is just basically, they have this, they can be broad spectrum. They're not absorbed through the cuticle. Many times they're phytotoxic, and there are others that are systemic that are gonna be absorbed into the plant. They're very, very specific. They are translocated through the vascular system from the plant, also from cell to cell. They are not subject to weathering, so basically, if it rains or it doesn't matter because it's already inside the plant. And you need probably less amount of the actual fungicide or the chemical product because they're going to be systemic and they're going to be inside, they're going to be circulating inside the plant, and they're going to provide probably like a better protection. But some of these ones are very, very specific, so they're for very specific pathogens. They're not like broad range. There are basically three main classes of fungicides. So you have the inorganic fungicides, which are like sulfur dusts and powders that are very broad spectrum, control mildews and rusts. They're very high phytotoxic. lime sulfur, which is just basically for history only because they're very phytotoxic, and it was broadly used for apple scab, but it's no longer in use. We have the copper, which it also works for bacteria, but it also works for fungi. And this is just like the Bordeaux mix from 1882. This is a very important, it's highly phytotoxic, but it's effective against fungi and bacteria. So it's used. And then we have mercury, organomercurics on seeds that are just for seeds, turf, and some other fruits as well. So another type of fungicides is the protectant organics. And basically, diphenhydrocarbamates, which are sulfur-containing fungicides, are broad-spectrum and are widely used. Ethylene, diethylcarbamates, also part of it. Aromatic compounds like PCMB, it's a broad-spectrum that it's used for turf, like the brown patch in turf. Substituted aromatics is basically substitute some of the aromatics for phenol, like chlorothalonil that is used in Bravo, and it's also a broad spectrum fungicide. Heterocyclic fungicides like Captan that is used for seeds. And sometimes surfactants are also used. They're thought to prevent the interaction that is necessary for initiation of infection by some pathogens, and it's just basically because they create this coat on the top of the leaf, and basically it's believed that the pathogen cannot actually kind of penetrate, or it's hard for the pathogen to start the infection process. Systemic organics like benzimidazoles, like Benamil, used to be very important. Like Benamil in particular, it inhibits tubulin. Because it inhibits tubulin formation, there's no mitosis, so the fungi cannot divide and grow. However, just the change of one amino acid or a mutation for one amino acid from the fungus, then the Benamil is no longer active because it cannot bind tubulin anymore. So then Benamil, I don't believe it's in the markets anymore. Sterol inhibitors like thiazoles, ergosterols found in fungal membranes, inhibits the ergosterol, which is found in fungal membranes. Propiconazole, Banner, Alamo are some of the fungicides that contain this type of fungicide. Acylenolines, metalaxyl, are used for oomycete control, and those inhibit RNA synthesis. Some of these ones, like Ritomil, is one of them that contains some of these components. And then beta methocyacrylates, which is just basically a new class of pesticides compounds and are derived from some naturally occurring strobilines, and the biochemical mode of action is inhibition of the electron transport. So these are the types of fungicides that are available. For biological control of plant pathogens, the modes of actions are a little bit different. We may have antibiosis, competition, mycoparasitism, hypervirulence, and induced resistance. So for antibiosis, basically, for example, Agrobacterium retrobacter strain K84 produces bacteriosin. And this is an adenine analog but it lacks the 3' OH group and it's plasmid encoded. And then basically, it's an effective control. It competes for the wound side nutrients and produces antimicrobial compounds. And it's important, and it works basically very similar to Agrobacterium, except that it doesn't infect. For antibiosis, also suppressive soils Some of the suppressive soils may have rhizobacteria communities that basically produce a lot of antimicrobial compounds that may suppress the presence of pathogens. Like soil bacteria, like Pseudomonas species, some of them, they may colonize the root tissue and produce phenacin and other compounds that are very, that inhibit the growth of other pathogens. Some soil fungi, they may also produce some chemicals that are inhibitory for other pathogens, like Trichoderma producing chitinases and actinomycetes that produce antimicrobial compounds. So a lot of pathogens, not just bacteria, but also fungi, may also be working as for antibiosis. Another way for biological control is competition. So basically, if some biological control agent fills a niche, in the case, for example, Pseudomonas fluorescens, the bacterium suppresses fire blight disease by competitive exclusion of the pathogen from flowers. So because Erwinia milovora enters the plant and it infects the flowers first, and it enters the plant from the flowers, if Pseudomonas fluorescens is already there, then the bacterium Erwinia cannot colonize the flowers. So basically, it's just the niche is filled, then the pathogen cannot colonize that same niche. Also, nutrient competition. Sometimes the saprophytes, some of the saprophytes are more aggressive, and in the sense that they're better qualified for nutrient acquisition. And some of these pathogens, they may be very good pathogens, but at the same time, in a saprophytic lifestyle, they may not be as good as at acquiring nutrients, and they cannot compete with others that are more saprophytic or have a better saprophytic lifestyle. Mycoparasitism is just basically some fungi may work against other fungus because they degrade their cell walls by chitinases. So that's the example of Trichoderma working against Rhizoctonia. And some of the advantages of microparasitism is just basically they're not dependent on external carbon sources for the activity or production of some of those compounds. Their active agent is not subject to binding by soils, and they're tolerant to the environmental conditions. So microparasitism is also effective. And hypervirulence, an example would be a double-stranded RNA virus that works against the pathogen or the fungus that causes chestnut blight. And basically the action is that it down-regulates the enzymes associated with the infection process, and also the fungus has low sporulation. So basically this virus that infects the fungus is gonna make it less virulent, and it's a way of controlling the disease. And finally, induced resistance, cross protection, either inoculate a plant with incompatible strain before challenging with a compatible strain. So basically, it's just mild strains of a viral pathogen to induce resistance in plant. Turn on plant resistance mechanisms, either by Rhizobacterium or other root bacteria that may be introducing some of the plant diseases, may induce resistance to some plant diseases just because they activate the defense responses from the plant. So with this, it's just basically wrapping up the lecture for today, which we just discussed about the principles for plant disease management. And we discussed some of the strategies that are used for disease control. Thank you, and see you next class.